Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webcast. Today's webcast is an introduction to the current IAASB consultation paper on extended external reporting, which is open for comment on the IAASB's website. Please note that you can ask your questions by typing them in the question box on the webcast control panel, and we'll endeavour to answer some of the questions during the webinar. On the line today, we have our panelists, Marek Grabowski, the chair of the Extended External Reporting Assurance Task Force. And we also have Josephine Jackson, who will be assisting Marek with some of the questions. I turn over to you now, Marek. Please begin.
Welcome, everybody, and thank you for your interest in this project. I'd like to start by next slide, giving you a brief bit of background to the project. The term EER stands for Extended External Reporting and covers a wide range of reporting by entities that goes beyond the traditional financial statements, but provides information about the company and its performance and so on. In many cases, this could include integrated reporting, sustainability reports, and so on. The project objective comes in two parts. It's to enable more consistent and appropriate application of our standard on the performance of assurance engagements other than audits and reviews of financial statements, ISAE 3000. I'll just refer to that as the standard during this call. And secondly, to enhance trust in assurance reports by users of that reporting, the EER reporting. The IAASB consulted with a discussion paper back in 2016, and in that consultation paper identified 10 key challenges in applying the standard in an EER assurance engagement. And the respondents to that supported the nature of those challenges and the need for guidance in relation to the application of the standard, but also said that it wasn't appropriate at this stage, at least, to develop a separate standard beyond 3000, a subject matter specific ISAE. So the IAASB project is designed to achieve the objective of the project by developing non-authoritative guidance in applying the standard. So that is what we're working on. And as many of you will know, the phase one consultation paper was released in February 2019. That consultation paper reflects the work of the task force to date in developing guidance on some of the challenges. The remainder of those challenges will be addressed in a second phase, which we've already started working on. The consultation paper sets out draft guidance based on our work to date, which also shows a possible structure for the document that we, the guidance document that we could produce at the end of phase two, and asks a number of questions, as usual, about various aspects of the guidance. The comment period for that closes in about a week's time, and we're looking forward to receiving input at this stage. At the end of this slide, you can see the broad timetable. So from the discussion paper back in 2016, approval of the project in late 2017, the consultation paper, which was published in February, and then somewhere in very early 2020, we hope to issue an exposure draft of the combined guidance from phases one and two, and by late 2020, next year, to have published the final guidance. So that's the timetable we're working towards, and we recognise that this is reasonably ambitious, but are continuing to aim towards that, those dates. Next slide, please. So in terms of what else is in the consultation paper in a little bit more detail, there is an explanatory memorandum which sets out some background to the way in which we've approached the guidance and to explain some of the key points that are addressed in the guidance, the draft guidance to date at least. All of that is building up to provide a basis for the questions that are set out in the consultation paper. Of course, there is then the draft guidance at that stage. And then there are two other papers. The first of those is a relatively short paper discussing some background and contextual information in understanding how subject matter information results from measuring or evaluating the underlying subject matter against the criteria. And then the second of those two additional papers is a revision, an update of a piece of information on a four key factor model for credibility and trust, which we first presented in the 2016 discussion paper. Its diagrammatic form is at the bottom of this slide, and those of you who followed the project at that stage will recall that the four key factors are the ones highlighted here in yellow: the need for a sound reporting framework, strong governance in preparing EER information. These together generate internal user credibility and trust in the report at the governance level and enable the entity to issue a high quality external report. In thinking then externally, in terms of external user credibility and trust, two more factors contribute to that. One is consistency of that report with the wider information available to the intended users of the report. And the fourth one, various possible external professional services and other reports, one type of which is an assurance engagement on the EER report under our standard. These build to external user credibility and trust. And in the responses to the 2016 discussion paper, there was a strong support for this model and a call for us to publish an updated version, which we've done at this stage in terms of receiving further comments from respondents on this. But the intent is to then make it available in addition to the guidance. And next slide, please. So next, really, just to give you a little bit more detail on the scope of the guidance in phase one and how much progress we made in the work to date at the time we issued the consultation paper. The final guidance is not intended to address all aspects of an EER assurance engagement, but rather only those aspects related to the 10 key challenges that we identified. The EER assurance house under construction, as we call it, that you see there on this slide, summarizes the 10 key challenges. And you'll see from this that actually they do cover quite a lot of the range of material that's covered in ISAE 3000 revised. But these are the areas where the challenges were identified, and the guidance is going to be directed towards helping practitioners to address those particular challenges. So in order to give the guidance structurally some more robustness and link back to the standard, we've included a very short chapter 2, which does provide an overview of all aspects of an EER assurance engagement and highlights the extent to which each of those is intended to be addressed in the final guidance. What have we done so far? If you're looking at the diagram, the areas highlighted in solid orange, these are challenges 2, 3, four and five. These four challenges address the suitability of criteria, the application of the concept of materiality, the use of assertions by the practitioner, and what we called maturity and governance and internal control, the implications of how mature an entity's governance and internal control system relevant to EER reporting is. These are pretty foundational and really all are interrelated in different ways and are particularly interrelated also to some of the preconditions which we'll come on to. And then there were two areas of reporting, in particular types of subject matter information that were encountered in EER reports that were highlighted as being particularly or giving rise in particular to certain types of challenge in addressing them. And those are narrative and future oriented information, challenges 6 and 7. So the way we've approached those two with respect to the phase one guidance is to look at those aspects of those challenges which are coincident with the challenge, the guidance on challenges 2 to 5. And then what's left to address in relation to narrative and future oriented information, essentially challenges around evidence and around reporting, assurance practitioner reporting, those will be picked up in the phase two guidance, along with challenges, the other challenges that are listed out here, 1, 8, 9, and 10, dealing with the assurance report, the scoping of an EER assurance engagement, the exercise of professional skepticism and professional judgment, and the competence necessary to perform the engagement. And as I mentioned earlier, whilst the consultation paper has been out, the task force has been active in working on these remaining challenges and remaining work, and we'll be having a first discussion with the board on them at the meeting next week in New York. So for those of you who are interested, the papers for the board are available on the IAASB's website, and you can see some of the work that has been done already by the task force to progress the remaining challenges. New slide, please. This slide really talks a little bit about how the draft guidance relates to the standard. I highlighted the way in which we addressed the overall relationship in chapter 2, but some other points that are really quite important and which we're interested in feedback from respondents on, and interested to hear what comments or questions you have around these things too on this call. So the first point we want to make is that the guidance is intended to be framework neutral. By that we mean neutral with regard to whichever EER framework is used by the preparer. And that includes very often in these cases, almost always, entity developed criteria too. So there's quite a focus on looking at the issues from both the framework perspective and the entity developed criteria perspective, but also remaining framework neutral, and then using examples to illustrate specific types or how the information might be applied to particular types of information or underlying subject matter in the EER reports. So in conclusion, the guidance is principle-based, but with practical application examples that help to link it to particular types of information. The next point to make is that the guidance does not add any requirements and does not remove or change any of the requirements or application material in the standard. The standard is still, you know, as it is, and is not intended to be changed in any way. This is truly intended to be guidance in applying that standard. However, and this is an important area to receive feedback on, the guidance does supplement the requirements or application material in some areas, because in some areas the challenges that are being raised in our view couldn't have been addressed without providing something additional. But we are interested in the views of respondents on that. It also covers some things that are not addressed in the standard. For example, how to consider an entity's materiality process. We'll come back to this a little bit later in the presentation. But the materiality process is recognized as something that happens in EER assurance engagements. It's a preparer process, but it is rare for the process that's described as a materiality process really to be applied in an audit of financial statements. And so it is a clear and distinguishing mark of these types of reports, and is not expressly or explicitly addressed in the standard. The other area that I might highlight as not being explicitly addressed in the standard, but it is addressed in the greenhouse gas standard, is whether or how practitioners might use assertions in assisting them to perform the engagement. So this is another area where I believed it was important, given that one of the key challenges that we were asked to address was how to build appropriate assertions in the case of an EER assurance engagement, an area where we believed it was necessary to go beyond what's in the standard. However, in doing that, we have any addressing anything that goes beyond in the sense of being supplementary, we have built that material based on the IAASB's other standards and the international framework for assurance engagements. The last item on this slide just also starts to look at terms that we use. In general, we have used the same terms that are used in the standard throughout the guidance. We think that's most helpful. But there are some supplementary terms that we've used in order to try and explain certain things. So, for example, when looking at underlying subject matter, we think it's very helpful to look at what that means in terms of identifiable underlying subject matter. What are the items that underlying subject matter comprises, and what is it about those items that is being measured or evaluated? And for those two things, the items, we've called them elements, and for the what it is about them that's being measured or evaluated, we've called that their relevant qualities, in effect. the term elements, at least, is consistent with the way in which the equivalent items that comprise the underlying subject matter in a set of financial statements are described. They're described as elements of the financial statements. Qualities is a term of art, in a sense, because we had to choose something, and we know that different terms could be used for it. For example, some have suggested the word properties, could be used instead. We've just chosen words in this area to enable us to describe something in a way that we don't have to keep coming back to a lengthy description of it, and it's helpful in writing the guidance. But the other area where we've coined the term materiality process, but we recognize that materiality process as a term uses the term materiality in a way that is slightly alien in terms of the language that we use in ISAE 3000 and also in the international framework. The materiality process is really more related to developing criteria when the preparer develops additional criteria beyond those in the framework they might be using to identify what items should be addressed in their report. And this is commonly referred to by preparers and other standard setters for preparing EER reports as a materiality process. But we know that in 3000, the term materiality is really a concept that applies to identifying which misstatements are material. The question of what is an appropriate item to include is a question of relevance, a criterion question, and materiality is really a question of the subject matter information that results from applying those criteria. So we're somewhat sensitive to not misleading people by the use of this term, and so every time we use materiality process in the guidance, we've got it in quotes and we've explained how it's different, that use of the term materiality there is different, and that is very much a preparer process. Next slide, please. On this slide, we've just summarised the key elements of the draft guidance that's resulted from phase one. These are the chapters beyond chapter two, which have got more information in them at this stage. And so we deal with the system of internal control, which is the way in which we've chosen to address what was called in the challenge maturity in governance and internal control. Calling it system of internal control is consistent with the way in which our standards generally describe these types of issues and is consistent with COSO. In terms of criteria, that's addressed in chapter 7. The challenges relating to the materiality process, part of what was in challenge 3, is in chapter 8. Materiality considerations in relation to misstatements of subject matter information addressed in chapter 12, assertions in 9, and then these two types of information that pose particular challenges in EER. Reports, narrative and future-oriented information are addressed in chapters 10 and 11. And other chapters will be there in the final guidance. And if you look at the content page, you'll see how we see those integrating in due course. Next slide, please. I said I'd come back to the preconditions for an assurance engagement. These are addressed in chapter 3 of the guidance, draft guidance, and a few things that are important to say about them. There weren't any specific challenges separate challenges identified around preconditions. But as we delved into some of the other challenges in the phase one part or in addressing some of the phase one challenges, we recognised that we needed to include a brief collective overview of the preconditions in an EER assurance engagement, because these are the starting point for discussing how some preconditions relate to other identified challenges and related matters, particularly the challenges relating to the maturity of governance and internal control and the suitability of criteria. This diagram here is taken from the guidance. It shows in the grey boxes the seven preconditions, and it shows in the white solid boxes some of the key elements of those preconditions that result in links between these various items and challenges related to, for example, internal control, the process to prepare the report, and so on. There's a dotted line box which asks the question, is the process to prepare the report adequate? The process to prepare the report is part of the system of internal control. It's addressed in chapter six. But you can see that there are links between whether the underlying subject matter is appropriate and also whether the preparer has a reasonable basis for the subject matter information, and whether the practitioner expects to be able to obtain the evidence needed. So the explanation on this slide is really to say that we believed that it was necessary to say some general things about how the preconditions relate to the other challenges, and we're particularly interested in hearing back about the work we've done in this area. Next slide, please. So moving on to chapter six, we had a lengthy discussion about the degree of maturity in the entity's systems. And in one direction, there's a concern that we should not be suggesting that the bar for systems of internal control should be very, very high. Of course, the higher the quality of the system of internal control, including the process to prepare it, prepare the information, the reporting system, the better prepared the entity will be to receive an assurance engagement. But the question we felt it was most important to address is, how far do you need to be along that line in terms of the development of your governance and internal control in order for the practitioner to be able to accept and therefore to expect to be able to fully perform an assurance engagement? Obviously, you know, there is no precondition, no one precondition that addresses internal control, but we believe that these two preconditions highlighted here, that the roles and responsibilities of the preparer are suitable, and in particular that they have a suitable basis for the preparation of the EER reports, and that the practitioner expects to be able to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence, sufficient appropriate evidence. These are two things that will through the preconditions, condition the practitioner's view as to whether or not the preparer's process is adequate to enable them to determine that those two preconditions are present. So that's the way in which we've approached it. Looking at internal control itself, we summarized it in terms of the five elements that will be familiar to someone performing an audit engagement. There's a control environment, a risk assessment process, a process to monitor the system, and then underlying that, the reporting system and the control activities that, at least in considerable part, would control the process and enable effective control of the process to prepare the information. The guidance provides examples of aspects of each of these components of the system of internal control that the practitioner may wish to consider in looking at those two preconditions above. Looking at these areas may also assist the practitioner more broadly in understanding the engagement circumstances, something that is important in once the engagement's been accepted. So we think that guidance may also assist in that area. And the system of internal control being adequate is really a judgment that the practitioner needs to make using professional judgment, taking into account the circumstances, the engagement, including factors such as the size and complexity of the entity and the nature of the reporting and so on. New slide, please. In terms of the challenge on criteria, the guidance describes criteria, explains what it means for criteria to be suitable. In practice, in an EER assurance engagement, the criteria often comprise a combination of criteria that could have been taken from one or more EER frameworks, as well as entity-developed criteria. This emphasis on the entity-developed criteria provides a link to the materiality process, which I'll mention further in a moment. But in more general terms, the guidance provides an explanation as to how the five characteristics of suitable criteria may be understood in an EER assurance engagement. We give a number of examples to assist practitioners in determining whether the criteria that they expect to be applied are suitable. One of the reasons why this is more important, maybe not more important is the wrong word, but more substantive, an exercise in an EER assurance engagement, is the fact that, as identified in the discussion paper, criteria in frameworks are generally less well developed, less fully developed than, but for example, by comparison, financial reporting frameworks. Now, to some extent, that's not necessarily a criticism of frameworks. It's in many respects not possible really to delve down into the level of detail that you would need to do to cover all possible areas. And so this is why entity developed criteria are so important. But therefore the process of evaluating criteria ought to be expected to be a more significant activity in certainly the more complex EER engagements and assurance engagements, and to some extent in probably all. And next slide, please. So I said I'd say a little bit further about the materiality process. Some of this I've already covered, so we'll come through it fairly quickly, but this is the last slide before I pause and give you a chance to ask some questions or to make some comments. That'll be coming up in a few moments. So if you have anything you would like to raise or to comment on, please do use the facility on the webinar to submit your question, and we'll come to those in a moment. So first of all, I've already talked about the term, and essentially what this process involves is the preparer making judgments about what to include in the EER report. Effectively, they are extending the criteria for what should be included in the report, such that overall, if you take the criteria together, they do sufficiently exhibit the characteristics of relevance and completeness. This process can be quite substantive, as I said. Of course, in some other cases, it may be quite limited. So, you know, one shouldn't also take it that in all cases there'll be a very extensive piece of work here, with, you know, in an engagement in which there is a straightforward greenhouse gas statement, only dealing with relatively straightforward elements. It may be that the criteria that are available are very straightforward to apply and don't require substantial increments to make them suitable. So it does depend on the nature of what's being and scope of what's being assured. The guidance aims to help practitioners through the process of considering an entity's materiality process, first by reviewing the context of that process and then reviewing the results of the process. And it suggests an approach for practitioners that could be applied regardless of the EER framework the preparer is using. And that's supplemented with practical examples. I've already described the difference between the use of materiality in this term and its proper use in our standard, which is in the context of potential and identified misstatements, and we'll come on to that in the second part of the session when we look at chapter 12. So I'd like to pause there, Brett, and I don't know if there's anything you would like to add in terms of how to raise questions, but I'll pause and we'll move to that section now. Thank you.
Thank you, Marek. If people do have questions, please feel free to fill out the questions in the control box on the right-hand side of your screen. Josephine, can I turn over to you to raise any questions that have been asked already with Marek?
Yes, thanks, Brett. Thank you, everybody. Good morning. Marek, we have a few questions coming through this morning, and I'll just ask them individually if that's better rather than throw them all at you at once.
Good idea.
The first question we have is some clarity around what subject matters are included in the scope of the consultation on EER. For example, is sustainability a subject matter that's included in the scope? And is that it, or is there more anticipated?
Sure. It's a challenge to be very specific about what's included. And so in practice, when we talk about this, we try to highlight examples of the types of reporting that are covered, and therefore of the nature of the underlying subject matter. The first thing I would say is that we think about it from the point of view of reporting by an entity about its performance in certain areas and the condition in which its performance activities, the activities underlying its performance sit at a particular point in time. So it is it's a broader view of the entity. EER reports could include, to give you some examples, a sustainability report. They could include an integrated report. They could include a performance report by a public sector entity. They could include the MD&A that an entity submits in a filing with a regulator, or these things can be called by other names, you know, OFR or a strategic report or a business development report for a development of the business report by an entity. So basically the sort of material that you would find in an annual report or information that you might find provided on broader non-financial aspects of an entity's performance. The thing that's not included is the financial statements and the interim financial statements of the entity. Those are covered by our international standards on auditing, and those are not covered here. But information that may include financial information extracted from other sources, like the financial statements, could be included in, for example, an integrated report and so on. Now, what's excluded? Well, nothing's explicitly excluded, because a lot of things like governance, matters could be included, which could include, descriptions of the oversight by the board of directors. Could include, to some extent, a report on the entity's performance in relation to environment, social activities, and its impact. There are some things that probably would not be included. It would not include, for example, one would not expect this to include things like a report on the performance in terms of internal control or compliance with law and regulation. Specific reports of those types are not really what we envisage here. So we're writing material that, of course, is about a very broad subject, a range of subject matters, and so the guidance is quite broad in its scope. But we have in mind the sorts of things that I've described when looking at this, and find it very difficult to narrow that down to something very definitive. But I hope that helps to understand how we're looking at it. Certainly if you have some specific questions about is X included in us thinking about this material, please ask those further. Thanks.
Okay. Another question that's come through is, having run through this process, have you identified, or you identified any areas in ISAE 3000 that may actually need amendment or revision? For example, there are some comments that the focus on internal control, for example, seems to go beyond ISAE 3000. So do you anticipate some revisions to 3000 as a result of this process? Thank you.
At this stage, we've not specifically identified and brought to the board any particular areas that we think result from these challenges, which can't be addressed by thinking about it in the context of what is in 3000 already. But there are possible questions that could arise as we go through the remainder of the process. Particularly, we've asked questions and we hope to get responses from individuals about the areas where we have supplemented what's in 3000 today. or provided additional guidance that's not explicitly addressed in 3000. Having said that, in many of those areas, there is guidance in another ISAE, and therefore, you know, we're not being inconsistent with that, and we certainly have stayed within the scope of what is addressed in the International Framework for Insurance Engagements. So I think it's possible that as we go through the process, we might identify some things where we say, you know, this is something the board could think about in future, but at the moment we're not at that point, and we're interested to see if in looking at what we've said in response to the phase one guidance, or indeed whether in future when the full exposure draft of the guidance is available, respondents think that there is something that we should at least recommend to the board to consider in future for revision in 3000. One area that we will look at further in phase two, which has come up a few times, is this question of financial information that's included. ISAE 3000 is intended to be used other than for audits or reviews of financial statements. And that includes you know, financial statements, whether they're complete sets or parts, if you like. Those things, in other words, that are dealt with by our auditing standards, the ISAs, or by the review standards. But that doesn't mean that ISAE 3000 can't address subject matters that are integrated with other information. And so maybe being clearer about that is something that we have to think about as we look at the phase two material. And that's possibly an area where, you know, there may be more questions about whether or not 3000 could be more explicit about that issue. But these are areas that we're interested in hearing from our respondents about. And if you think there are particular areas, then I would certainly be very interested to hear that when hopefully you will all respond. In terms of internal control explicitly, I think what we've tried to do is to link the consideration of the issue which the board has approved in the project proposal as something we should look at. We've tried to address it in the context of the existing requirements in 3000. And the question there is that enough? Should we only look at it in that respect? Or are there other questions that one could look at? If we hear otherwise in the responses to the first phase consultation paper, we'll need to look at that. But as a task force, we were satisfied that we felt we had addressed the challenges identified sufficiently in approaching it in the way that we had. Thank you.
Thank you, Marek. Perhaps another question, if I may. How do you think that investors and other consumers of business information will actually benefit from the proposals and the consultation?
Thanks. That's a really important question, in fact. And this guidance is directed, as I already said, towards assisting practitioners in applying our standard. The whole purpose of an assurance engagement ultimately is to enhance in a justifiable way the confidence that the intended users, investors and other consumers that are relevant to that report, to enhance their confidence in the EER report, so that they feel more able to use that information in their decision making, whatever the nature of that decision making. As a task force, one of the golden threads that we've identified is that link to the intended user in everything that we've looked at so far. I have to say that has continued to occur as we've gone through the phase two challenges that we've been looking at over the last several months. So the way in which I think the guidance is going to benefit the intended user is by us drawing out very important sightings of that thread, the golden thread, in each of these issues. I'll just give you one example, the importance of looking at the rational purpose of an engagement as part of engagement acceptance underpins that user perspective and need for information and need for assurance. And something that pops up, therefore, as one moves on to look at questions like evidence and so on. How will it benefit them is therefore that through this guidance, the standard will be, we hope, more consistently applied in the manner in which it was intended to, with a clear and significant focus on the objective, which is to enhance confidence, and as I say, in a justifiable way. So hopefully that explains it. And whether in fact the guidance speaks to investors is a different question, which I'm not answering in what I've said so far, but it is also a separate and important question and maybe behind some of what the questioner is intending to ask here. So maybe just a word or two on that. I do think there is a very strong need for engagement and communication to help users understand what assurance they can take from an assurance conclusion reached after performing an engagement under our standard and in accordance with this guidance. And one of the things I'm very pleased is happening is that this project is being funded by the WBCSD and the Moore Foundation. They have, the WBCSD has a number of projects around this, including a number that are looking at communications with investors and indeed also communications with preparers to try and draw together how the, for example, how a preparer should think in terms of buying such a service in such a way that it will be useful to investors. How should investors, what should they take from the from such an engagement, and why is it of benefit to them? And of course our guidance then is the basis potentially for those types of communications, because it provides the way in which the practitioner focuses on the user throughout the engagement. Thank you. I think at this stage that's the principal questions we've got. There are probably some others, but maybe we'll move on to the second stage, and if there are remaining questions from this, we can also pick those up later in the next questions session. So Brett, can we move to the next slide, please? So I'm continuing with the challenges. Materiality is challenge three, and that's addressed in chapter 12 of the draft guidance. EER reports cover diverse subject matters. In many cases, you can receive an EER report that's narrowly focused on something like a greenhouse gas statement, but generally they include diverse information about diverse subject matters, underlying subject matters. The information that results from applying the criteria to the underlying subject matters is not measured or evaluated in a common unit, something that does occur for all the elements of the financial statements. And it includes significant amounts of narrative information, and I should say also a significant amounts of forward-looking information, in both cases relative to financial statements. That's not to say that financial statements don't include any forward-looking or narrative information. They do, and there are clearly parallels between how between the challenges that, if you like, that have been identified here in relation to materiality and some of those that are addressed when that type of information is presented in financial statements. But that is that's the reason why materiality assessments can be difficult, because when trying to judge if something is material, it's in the context of the EER report as a whole, and therefore one has to make judgments about whether a misstatement in one area of subject matter on its own is material, and a misstatement in another subject matter in this diverse group of information is material on its own. But you then also have to consider those misstatements in aggregate, collectively, to consider whether or not, even if they're not individually material, they would be regarded as material overall. It's also because there isn't you know, necessarily a common unit of measurement, then the nature of the information, particularly when it's narrative, qualitative, and non-quantity information, even the basic concept that's used in financial reporting, that there is an amount which would be material in that common unit of currency, can't be the basis on which you evaluate things. And this is why the challenge was identified, or the essence of the challenge is, how do you make those materiality assessments? Well, essentially you're making qualitative assessments. Materiality is not just a quantitative issue, it's also qualitative. And so the qualitative aspects are far more important in these types of reports. They're not uniquely so, because we also have that issue in financial statement audits, where there is qualitative aspects to information, particularly information disclosed in the notes. But actually also there can be qualitative aspects of amounts that are reported in financial statements that have to be taken into account. So I think what we believe, having looked at this subject, is that it's not something new, it's something that is much more commonly addressed in this area, and that particularly the accumulation of misstatements in very different underlying subject matters, when there is no common unit of measurement, can be more of a challenge. It requires far more professional judgment. So what have we done? We've provided examples of matters that could assist a practitioner in considering whether a misstatement is material, with a big focus on the qualitative aspects. And then also guidance on how to accumulate misstatements when they are in such diverse types of information, considering, you know, how to link those together. But this is an area that is quite a significant challenge in practice, and we know that. And we hope that what we've drafted in the first phase consultation paper will form the basis for good feedback from respondents. Next slide, please, Brett. Challenge four was in relation to assertions, and that's addressed in chapter 9 of the draft guidance. The standard doesn't use the term and does not require their use. We note that at the beginning. Nonetheless, they are commonly used in EER assurance engagements in practice, and respondents to our discussion paper agreed that building those assertions was a key challenge for practitioners. So the guidance explains what assertions are. In doing so, it draws on the definitions in other IAASB standards, including other ISAEs. It explains how assertions result from the requirements of the applicable criteria and how they're reflected in the attributes of the subject matter information that results from applying those criteria to the underlying subject matter. It then goes on to provide guidance on identifying categories of assertions that may be used, similar to those that are set out in both the ISAs and in the greenhouse gas statement, ISAE. Some of those categories of assertions are implied by the characteristics of suitable criteria. That's not a surprise, because the characteristics of suitable criteria are really set out in terms of how, if those criteria are applied, what characteristics will the subject matter have? So therefore, those characteristics that are implied, the characteristics of the subject matter information that are implied, form the basis for groups of or categories of assertions. The second point that one would make, though, is that criteria are required to be suitable and therefore to have the characteristics of suitable criteria. But it's possible that those criteria also reflect other categories of assertions than those required to be suitable, which result from other characteristics of the applicable criteria. And you know, one area where we certainly have thought about whether or not that's a good example is connectivity. If we look at an integrated report, the importance of integration between all of the capitals and the information about those capitals is pretty critical. Now, is connectivity simply an aspect of understandability, or is it something that is different and gives rise to a different assertion? It's certainly an important aspect of the criteria when one's presenting an integrated report. And that is true in other aspects of EER reporting too. But that's just an example. So that's the way in which we've approached assertions. If we could move on to the next slide. This is a summary, really, just, or a schematic, just to show how what I said on the previous slide sort of comes together. So over on the left-hand side, applicable criteria are applied to underlying subject matter and give rise to the subject matter information highlighted in the middle of the slide. The five characteristics of suitable criteria are defined in terms of the attributes of subject matter information that results from applying them, and those are shown at the bottom of the slide. If those applicable criteria are properly applied, the resulting subject matter information should have the attributes that reflect the characteristics of suitable criteria. Assertions are assertions about the subject matter information. They're representations, we suggest, by the measurer or evaluator, which can be explicit or otherwise, that are embodied in the subject matter information as used, and these representations are used by the practitioner to consider the different types of potential misstatements that may occur. So that link between an assertion and a misstatement is critical, because if the criteria imply a characteristic of the subject matter information, there's an implicit assertion, if you like, on the presumption that the subject matter has been properly prepared in accordance with the criteria, that the subject matter information has that characteristic. And therefore, if that characteristic is not there, for example, if the subject matter in some way is not complete, then there is a misstatement of a type related to completeness. That's the essential approach that we built the guidance on, and we believe that that is consistent with the way in which assertions, misstatements, and the application of the characteristics of suitable criteria are established in the other standards. If we could move on then to the last area of challenge, of bringing together both challenges 6 and 7. And again, after this slide, we'll be moving to a second round of questions before we close. And so again, if you've got questions on this or on the earlier parts or anything else you want to comment on, please do think about that now as we go through this last slide. The draft guidance addresses challenges that arise in these three areas in relation to narrative and future-oriented information. As I said earlier, we'll look at the challenges that arise in relation to evidence and reporting in phase two. But so for the moment, we've focused on challenges that arise in determining the suitability of criteria that give rise to such information, in using assertions to evaluate such information, or in evaluating the resulting misstatements. The guidance, therefore, tends to be related back to some of the things that we've identified in the other chapters that I've already discussed. However, what we're trying to do in this area is to relate those to the particular nature of narrative and future-oriented information. Now, the common theme in these two areas that we've identified is that the criteria for them are usually more subjective and therefore have, if you like, a lower level of reliability within the context of still being suitable, but a lower level of reliability, more variation in the possible range of outcomes in terms of the subject matter information that can occur. And this underpins all of these questions, because the nature of the information that would result from applying them may, for example, need to include information about subjectivity or the uncertainty, the inherent uncertainty that underpins them, in order to give an appropriate description of the thing that the criteria are trying to measure or evaluate. I'm not going to go into the examples, but I will say that we do think that these two chapters, 10 and 11, are really something we intend to continue to look at, the way in which we've structured these. And we're looking at this at the board meeting next week, But if you have comments on the way in which we've structured these and the relationship to the other underlying challenges, we're quite interested in hearing about that too. But based on where we are at the moment, much of what you see in these two chapters is really going to be examples of applying issues that are already addressed in more general terms in the other, some of the other chapters. Now that's all I needed and wanted to say about the guidance, and Brett, if we're ready to do that, I'm happy to move to questions again.
Thank you, Marek. Again, if you have any questions, please feel free to pose them in the control panel on the right-hand side of your screen. Josephine, are there any questions you would like to ask Marek?
Thanks, Brett. And I just have one more for Marek that's come through. Marek, if you could just give a little bit more clarity on phase two, please. For example, will respondents see the outcome of a consultation on phase one before phase two guidance is issued, for example, or have some idea of the board's considerations of the consultation responses? Thank you.
Yes, thank you for that question. The plan that that we have is to look at the consultation responses and develop a feedback statement to summarise what we hear. So that will be published, we hope, after the September board meeting. The way in which we'll use that feedback, though, is if you want to follow along how we do that, the best way to do that will be to follow along with the board papers for September and December. Once the feedback document is out there, that will summarise the information, and of course, as usual, all the responses will be published. Excuse me. But the way in which the task force will look at this material is twofold. First of all, it will inform us in updating the guidance we developed in phase one. And that will be reflected in the complete exposure draft planned for the end of the year. The second way in which we'll use that feedback, though, is to consider the implications for structure, terminology, approach, all those things I dealt with on the first few slides in this webinar. Throughout the whole of the guidance. So it will have implications for updating the phase one draft guidance, but also in formulating the structure and nature of the guidance that appears in total, if you like, pulling together the material we developed in phase one with the new material we develop in phase two. It will inform how we present that information, and that will all be discussed with the board over the next two board meetings, well, three board meetings, but in terms of the implications of the feedback that we receive, we'll discuss those in September and December in our issues papers. So I hope that answers the question, but that's how I see that working.
Thank you, Marek. I have one other question that's just popped through. There is some clarity required around the assertions. For example, in the ISAs, the assertions are not the same as the characteristics of suitable criteria. So what characteristics of suitable criteria will management use to assert the existence of something else? Thank you.
Any lack of clarity is something that respondents will highlight. But first of all, we're not suggesting that the characteristics of suitable criteria are the same. There are a number of reasons why that's the case. They're not the same as the assertions because, first of all, the the language that a standard setter preparing criteria for EER might use might be different from the language that the IAASB has used for characteristics of suitable criteria. But it's the what they are related to, the assertions, is the descriptions of what subject matter information would look like if it was produced in accordance with criteria that had a particular or each characteristic of suitable criteria. So, in fact, excuse me, in fact, many of the categories of assertions that are listed in the ISAEs do cross over very easily. It's easy to see how they cross over to the related characteristics of suitable criteria. In other cases, assertions may in fact be addressing the words in an assertion might be addressing the nature of the item, whether it exists is a case in point. So criteria set out both the nature of the underlying subject matter element that's being measured, its characteristic or quality, as we called it, that is being measured or evaluated, and then to go with that, the benchmarks that are used. But in order to describe the benchmarks, it's necessary to say what they're being applied to, and so that's how one gets to a criterion says subject matter element X should be evaluated using this benchmark to describe or measure this quality of that underlying subject matter element. And so some of the assertions actually are that you see in the ISAEs actually look at whether an asset exists, for example, or a liability exists, because there are definitions of what an asset or liability is that would meet the definition of an identifiable element in financial reporting, an identifiable subject matter element. We could get into a lot more detail on this. I'm not sure that it's helpful on a webinar, but I certainly would be very interested to hear from the person asking that question or anybody else if there are ways in which we are not being clear and where more clarity is needed. So a call on you to help us with that, because it's important to help people who are looking to build categories of assertions that are relevant in relation to EER to be able to do that without the guidance being explicitly provided in ISAE 3000 today. That's good. Is there anything else on the questions at the moment, Josephine?
Not the moment, thank you for that.
Brett, I can hand it back to you if I may. I think we seem to have heard at this stage the questions people have. I don't know whether there's facility for anyone to comment, but I'll leave that to you to address.
Okay, thank you, Marek and Josephine. That brings to an end our webinar for today. Thank you very much for participating. You can log off now.